This conference will now be recorded.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jessie Saintcyr, and I am your host today. It looks like someone is going to be joining us. So welcome, Joy. Thank you so much for joining us. But today we're going to be talking about job search strategies during the pandemic. And I have asked my friend, Dr. Tamika Jacques, to join in this session. She is an author and has extensive experience in workforce development. But if you're joining, or we'll just make sure that your device is on mute, but we'll have an opportunity to answer questions at the end. And if we see questions, feel free to just type in the chat. If there's a question you'd like to ask during the session, feel free to include that, and we will we'll make sure to get to it as well. Okay. So again, my name is Jessie Saintcyr, and I am the principal owner of Saintcyr Consulting. In terms of my background, I'm an attorney and have extensive experience in HR at the C-suite level, and have worked on boards, presented to boards, advised boards on a number of workforce-related issues. And I'm very, very passionate about investing in people. My motto is that leadership is not about a title or position. It's really about empowering people, positioning them for success, and really building the next generation of leaders. Just one fun fact about me, I am the third of 10 children. Whenever I say that, people tend to gasp. Same parents. Most of my family is on the East Coast. I'm a native of Massachusetts, but it's always been fun being raised with 9 other siblings. So I am, again, the principal owner of Saintcyr Consulting, and what we do is leadership development, management training, faith-based training, and also executive coaching. And information is below if you'd like more information about the organization. But I've asked my friend, Dr. Tamika Jacques, to join. We met as members of a panel at a women's conference a few years ago. And she is the author of a very important book that I think many of you should take advantage of. But I want her to just share some information about herself beyond her stellar background and extensive education in this area.
Thank you so much, Jesse. Thanks for having me tonight. Yes, I can't say I'm 3 of 10, and my fun fact would only be 1 of 1. So I will, my fun fact that I like to give out is, actually that Jesse helped me with, come up with this fun fact, is that if you look at my picture, I have blue eyes, and I have 2 parents that are African Americans. So I'm sure you know what the next question people would ask me, but I just, you know, answered it for you. But blue eyes runs in my family, and so there's many of us in my family. It's a common theme in my family. My cousins have blue eyes. We all have blue eyes. So wow. that's my fun fact.
Well, I thought you were the anomaly. I didn't realize it.
No.
No. I'm learning. I'm still learning. That's great. So you also wrote this book, A Brown Girl's Guide to Employment and Networking. Can you talk about that?
Sure. Yeah. So A Brown's Guide to Employment and Networking is, you know, based on experiences, how I've had to develop my career, going through different pathways, having to call on people, and just really making sure that my network was, you know, in tight formation. And also it comes from, you know, not being promoted at different times in my career, and just wanting others to see, you know, maybe identify with others the things that they've gone through, but also just instructing people that, you know, keep networking no matter, you know, who says no to you about a certain position or, you know, a certain job. Just keep networking, keep going. And so this book was, you know, meant to be an encouragement to all the brown girls out there. The book is for all ladies, but it was just a shout out to all the brown girls.
Yeah, and you've already shared some tips in our conversations as we were preparing for this session. You've already shared some tips that I'm going to apply. So go and get the book. How much is it?
Currently on Amazon, it is $14.99.
Okay, great. And so why don't we get started? Let me just take a second here. Someone is just texting me, I apologize, and is trying to join. And of course, as I am a one man or one woman show, I want to make sure that she gets on. So let me do that. And I apologize, everybody. Okay, so what we're going to discuss today is really how to define your job search strategy, particularly in the pandemic, looking at what's happening to different industries, making a pivot, making adjustments as necessary. We're going to talk about how to create and update your resume in line with that strategy. We'll also talk about how to leverage networking best practices, particularly online, because a lot of states are still under shelter in place orders. And for those who have underlying health conditions, they still have to take certain precautions. Or if you're part of a vulnerable population, you definitely still want to take some precautions. So we'll talk about how to leverage networking online during this time. And then we'll also talk about how to prepare for remote interviews and onboarding processes. But we'd certainly love to hear from you about your thoughts. And if you have any tips that you'd like to pass on, please do that as well. So in terms of defining a job search strategy, I think the first thing you want to do is definitely assess where you are. And I've done this every time I've moved from one role to another, is to not rush into something else, but to take a step back and say, okay, what was that role like? What did I accomplish? What did I not like about it? What do I want to continue doing? And what do I not want to do in the next role, right? It really becomes an opportunity to detox, because if it was not a great experience, I definitely don't want to rush into something like that again. But if it was a great experience, how can I continue to build on that? So conduct an assessment. Where were you? Where are you? Where do you want to go? And think about it in terms of your work experience as well. Is that the type of work experience you want to continue to build on? Or do you want to make a departure? And this is also an opportunity to really think about your skills. What skills did you groom? What skills did you grow during that work experience? And what skills do you need to have for the next opportunity? And a lot of, you can find a lot of free trainings, free webinars, free videos on how to build different skills. And I was sharing in our last session that Steve Harvey actually posted something on his social media pages that Microsoft is offering a Microsoft Excel training that was very expensive, but I think is less than $40 now. So things like that. LinkedIn is another place. If you have, I think LinkedIn Premium, it's called LinkedIn Learning. Correct me if I'm wrong, Tamika.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's correct.
Yeah, so LinkedIn Learning has a lot of thousands, in fact, of sessions, trainings that you can take to help you build a skills or learn a new one. And if you're part of an organization, you definitely want to ask them what's available, especially if they have a learning and development department. Good opportunity to tap into that. And then think of your assessment in terms of your education. Sometimes we go to school for certain things and we've worked on them because we feel kind of guilty almost that we spent all this money on this education. We have to do this, but it's not what makes us happy. It really isn't fulfilling. And we just We just don't feel like we're contributing at the levels that we want to. So this is a time to take a step back and say, is this really what I want to do? Do I want to move in another direction? Tamika, what are your thoughts?
So thank you. Yeah. So, you know, just looking at, you know, point number three you made, talking about the skills and the upskill, you know, the great thing, I don't want to say the great thing about this pandemic, but, you know, we have technology that we can use during the pandemic. And, you know, I don't know, 40 years ago, 30 years ago, they didn't have this technology where you could, you know, have online learning. And just as an example, you know, as you mentioned, Jessie, I interviewed someone that was in the real estate industry, has only been in the real estate industry years, and she decided to take her course through Groupon. And so she went on Groupon, paid for her course. It was very short money. And next thing you know, she, you know, takes the course, goes into real estate, she gets rookie of the year, she doubles her sales the second year, so much that she doesn't have to pay commission to her broker anymore. So there is just ways to be creative during this pandemic, to upskill, to make sure that you're upskilling your own skills and getting that training for either, you know, very short dollars, as Jessie mentioned, very short time.
Okay. And that's an impressive, I mean, to go on Groupon. I really have never gotten anything on Groupon, but maybe I'll find something on there. That's innovative. That's a very interesting, cost-effective way of building a skill and being successful at it. Now, is that person, how is she navigating the job market? And if you don't mind, what area is she in?
So she's in this area in Massachusetts, in the South Shore area. And, you know, people think that real estate stops. It doesn't, because people, today is the 30th of April. Some people had told their tenant or their landlord they're moving out to their new house. So people still have to move. They still have to buy, or they still have to move into another spot. So real estate is moving. So I do follow her online, and I still see her saying sold, another property sold. So it is happening. It might not be at, you know, the fastest rate as it was in the beginning of the year, but she's still on, you know, par to have really good sales in 2020. So she's doing, you know, virtual tours, you know, through technology again, and making it happen. So yeah, she's doing really well.
Okay, that's great. That's a good success story. So the other thing that you want to think about in terms of your job search strategy is the current job market. Now, part of the U.S. is trying to open back up for business. The other part is still under shelter in place orders. So it's really important to see what industries are still heavily impacted. I mean, tens of millions of people have had to file for unemployment, and that's really a sad situation, but you know, there are industries that are still employing talent, right? So let's say the retail industry, for instance, you know, a lot of malls are closed or have been closed for a while. Some have had to, companies have had to file for bankruptcy, but there are other retail companies. And maybe Amazon is a tech company, but it's still providing services, right? And people can still shop online, and they are hiring a lot, and not just at the warehouse level or frontline level in their grocery stores, but they're also hiring in corporate at the higher levels of the company. So that's some place that you might want to consider. Walmart, again, not just at the frontline level or in stores or warehouses, but in the organization, in the company across the board. That's another company that's hiring. The Small Business Administration is also hiring, because they have tens of thousands of loans that they still need to process. And there was a story yesterday that National Bank of America has processed thousands of loans, and it's waiting on the SBA to process them. So there's a delay there, and they're looking for some additional support for those who can work from home or be able to come in and do some of their training and then work from home. So there are opportunities. Just think about, what do people need to survive? They need food, they need electricity, they need water, they need shelter, and they need just their utilities to work. So those industries are still hiring, because that's where the demand is. So think about your job strategy in those terms and make a pivot where you need to. See where your education, your skills, your work experience align. If you want to make a departure, this is the time to really think about that and what experience you can draw from and highlight as you build your resume. So in terms of building your resume, again, if you are looking to continue where you are, then you can just continue to build on that and highlight that. But I always say resumes really need to be 1 to 2 pages max. If you are maybe C-suite, if you're an executive, if you're looking for more of an executive level role, there are exceptions, of course. And I've had to recruit for C-suite positions of managed C-suite searches. But think about keeping it 1 to 2 pages and making sure that the top of your resume is really summarizing who you are in terms of your work experience. There should be no grammatical errors. There should be nothing that is distracting, so the format should be seamless. You should highlight, you know, your years of experience. What's your top skill? What's your top expertise? And why your resume should really convey in 3 to 5 seconds, and I'll tell you why 3 to 5 seconds, but convey what you want this employer to know about you as it pertains to the job opportunity and why you're the best candidate for that role. So one of the things that I do at the top of my resume is, I think one of the first sentences is, you know, experience or expert in HR, employment law, 20 plus years of combined experience, something like that. So they know exactly who I am and why they should hire me for the role. Any other thoughts, Tamika, on building a resume and some do's and don'ts?
Yeah, so, you know, along with what you said, you know, sometimes, and we'll talk about this in networking, you know, it's just, you know, you want to make sure that you have a resume ready. So sometimes, you know, depending on the job that you're applying for, yes, you know, you're going to tailor it. But once, you know, that process happens, it's always good to keep a resume that can still be generic, just in case you do meet someone, and we'll talk about this in a little bit, that if they say to you, do you have a resume? And then you're like, oh, I don't have one. I haven't updated it in 10 years. You don't want to make anyone wait to get that resume. So I just encourage you, and it's in my book, actually, that, you know, every 3 months you should really be updating your resume, because even if you're not looking for a job, you are building a skill every day. So if someone in your, if your immediate supervisor asked you, hey, can you take on this project? That should go on your resume. And, you know, or as you're taking on more projects, that should go on your resume so that it's always in front of you and it's always refreshed. So don't just think, oh my gosh, I've been in this job for, you know, 5 years doing the same thing. I think that if you really thought about it, you would see, oh, I started taking on this type of responsibility. And you can add those things to your resume to really help shape and form, you know, what you're leading up to or applying to, should I say.
That's a great, very, very good point. And then, you know, you want to make sure, and you kind of touched on this indirectly, is really tailor your resume to the opportunity. One of the reasons why you definitely want, just going back to conducting an assessment and tying it to this, The reason why you want to conduct is an assessment is because you want to have focus, right? Mm. I've been in HR since 2000, started at the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston, and did employment law and family law actually for a little bit. But I've seen thousands of resumes, and I've seen people apply for roles that really they had no qualifications. And it's time that you have to take looking at these resumes, but they don't have a shot. And so it's like when you see someone's name over and over again applying for a job that they're not qualified for, you really discredit yourself as a candidate. In a way, someone who is not clear on where they want to be and someone who is just applying for anything, it shows that there's really a lack of focus. So really think about that when you're applying for roles and that you're tailoring the resume to the job description and that your background also speaks to the position that you're applying for. I think that's really, really important. Mm-hmm. So the other thing is we talked about networking because networking is so important. You can have the best resume in the world. You can have the best job strategy in the world. But if no one knows you're looking or you don't have an opportunity to really leverage your contacts so that your resume can make it to decision makers, your strategy won't be as effective as you'd like it to be. So Tamika, talk about the value of a network for us.
Sure, I can talk about that. And I always like to define network when I'm talking about it. I think it's important that we just all on the same page. But when I define networking, I think of it as establishing a mutual beneficial professional relationship that goes, you know, back and forth, right? So you're establishing a relationship with other professionals that can last forever. Whether, you know, you decide to retire, you can still look back and call on them at some point. And some people say, oh yeah, I got that already. That's family. But mm-hmm. that's not how I look at networking as a family. I don't look at networking like that. I look at it as really you investing in other people professionally and vice versa, mentoring someone or mentoring someone back to you. But just to talk a little bit about the importance of it, you know, I think that if you look over the workforce system over the past, let's just say 100 years, we've always had the definition of nepotism, right? I think a lot of us, especially as a woman of color, you know, we've talked about it. What does nepotism mean? But I think when you have a network, it's good for nepotism to happen because that means that someone is choosing you based on a referral a lot of times, or someone is giving you kind of like that step in because they know you, they've seen your track record, they've seen your work, you know, someone else can vouch for you. And so when we talk about network, it's good because, you know, you do have a little bit of that nepotism, you know, in there. So, it's in the past, it's been used as a bad way. But when we talk about networking, I think it's a little bit form of nepotism because in networking, you want to be able to call someone and say, you know what, I saw a job at, you know, Saintcyr Consulting and they're offering this position. Do you think you can give Jessie a call for me? And so, yeah, that's the initial nepotism. And, you know, I think there needs to be, you know, more of that needs to happen because if you look at the statistics of when employers are hiring, 70% is done through word of mouth. Yeah. So that means that, you know, the network is someone referring to you because they know you or because they met you at an event, right? So that's really the value that I talk about of a network. It helps you to stay on, you know, the pulse of the industry. You gauge on what's happening in the industry, the trends, you talk about them with the person that you meet. So there's so many, you know, benefits to having such a great network. And when we talk about how to network, you know, in my book, I give solutions for the introverts, for the extroverts. And, you know, as an example of, you know, how to network is, let's say if you are an introvert, you know, so First of all, you want to let's talk about an event, even though we can't go anywhere during this pandemic right now. But let's talk about if we could all get together, right? If we could all get together and I was an introvert, I would show up, 10 minutes early for the event. That's what I would do, because once you come in late, people are talking, conversations are already established. The people that didn't know each other, now they know each other. So I would encourage you to arrive 10 minutes early so that you can look around the room, engage and see who's in there and see people's name tags. And then you don't even have to speak to them. But one thing I want to say is, put down your phone, because there's nothing worse than walking into an event and you look at someone and they have their phone in their hand and all they're doing is just scrolling down, and there's probably no one calling them, but because they're so shy. So I just want to encourage you, if you could, put your phone away for 15 minutes, put it away, because you don't look approachable. Smile, look approachable, smile. And then when you go to the event, say if you had listened to a panel, I don't want you to sit in the first row. I don't want you to sit in the last row. I want you to sit in the middle. Why? Because if you sit in the middle of the rows, you'll have someone in front of you, you'll have someone in back of you, you'll have someone to the right, and you'll have someone to the left. And chances are someone's going to have to walk over you to say, excuse me, they're going to sit next to you because they might be the extrovert. They're going to look at your name tag and you can start that conversation, going with them. So that's just some of the tips that I have in my book that can really teach you, how to network. And I just think it's important that, whether you're an extrovert or you're an introvert, that you know how to do that at least. That's to say that's for an event. Okay, now, so we know we can't go anywhere right now. Some people can't, depending on what part of the, the country you are in. Some of us, I'm in Massachusetts, so that everything is just, closed. So,
reopening.
Right. So it really depends. But what I would say is that there's so much out there online. There is, LinkedIn, you can go on LinkedIn and you can look at someone in your industry and send them an email, just say, hi, I'm interested in learning more. Would you be willing to talk with me? Send them an email. Or if you have a friend that can refer you, sometimes that's a little bit easier to do that introduction. I have to say, as well as, you want to talk to someone, have a virtual coffee with someone instead of having to meet them, go on Instagram and you can, have a conversation with them. Let others hear that conversation. That's another, option as well. Just, hey, I'm going to go Instagram live so we can talk face to face. So let's just see what happens. That's another way of doing it. But, you can go on Facebook and see someone also, maybe they have a company and they're leading that page. You can also go on Facebook and do that. So, I think that it's very easy these days, especially in this pandemic. You don't have to meet people. You can just send them a simple email and tell them about yourself. And I just want to say, be prepared to talk about yourself. Don't ever do something where you can't talk about yourself. If I just met you for the first time, I don't want you to stutter on what you do. I don't want to hear you, kind of mumble over your words on why you want to join the industry. So just be prepared for that as you're doing that online. Do you want to add anything in, Jessie?
Can I say there, so and this goes for business people. I'm in business, you're in business, you also are a leader in your organization. And so networking is not just for people who need jobs, it's also for business. I'm networking all the time, and I've actually gotten more people following me on social media because of the things that I'm sharing. And it's a way to really market what I do, right? And to expand my network at the same time. So one of the things that I do is if I'm reading a post and someone comments, and I look at their background and their background is of interest to me, or I think we should connect, I will send them a note through LinkedIn or Facebook or whatever and say, hey, I saw you on this, or I liked your comment, love to connect. And I used to actually just connect with people and not say anything, particularly on LinkedIn, because I think there's a is more of a norm that you want to follow for professionals. Mm-hmm. But I would just, send them a request to connect. But now I take the time to actually provide just a summary of why I think we should connect, or what I've seen or what I've heard, or why I think we may be able to support each other in some way. And then I send them the request. And most of the time, with almost without fail, I will always get my request accepted, So I think that's a good thing to do. Another thing I want to say in terms of the value of a network is that, no matter what circumstance you're in, you always want to be able to call someone. Your mm-hmm. network always have to be people who look like you, people who are in your same profession. I think you touched on that. But it really should be, just think about your life in segments. Do you know someone? I'm in HR. Do I know another person in HR? I'm an attorney. Do I know another attorney? Not just employment attorneys, but in different areas. I have family members who need different things. Do I know people who have those backgrounds? If I need a job, do I know people who are in high level positions, right? I'm in business. Do I know people who are in business, small business, large business, more seasoned professionals? Healthcare is a big issue right now. Getting answers, getting resources, being able to set up a doctor's visit. I know my doctor, I know my primary care physician, but do I know other doctors, right? So it's not all white collar professionals or blue collar professionals, but it really is a mix, so that no matter what the issue, financial, spiritual, emotional, family, education, whatever, I know someone. And I can reach out to them. So I don't have to have all the answers, but I need to know someone who might be able to get me to the answer. So that's what I would add there. But in terms of leveraging your network, I think you touched on it already. I've kind of shared some thoughts about that as well. It's just being able to have access and someone who can vouch for you. When you're applying for roles, or when you're trying to, if you're a business owner, you're trying to get new business, you really need someone to vouch for you. You need someone to say, yep, this person has worked with me, or I've met this person, and this is someone you definitely want to look at. The fact that 70% of jobs are by word of mouth or through networks that's valid. I mean, the CEO, the former CEO of LinkedIn, actually stepped down from his role because this is something he wants to spend more time looking into, because communities of color more often than not don't always have the types of networks that will move them into more high paying roles, right? And so he's taking a look at that, and for someone to actually do that is pretty serious. Mm-hmm. So networks are so important. That's a very, very important topic. Anything else here, Tamika, that you want to touch on?
No, I think you touched on it, and just, I would say, don't be afraid to ask, don't let pride get in your way. I think, the more that you are building and leveraging your network, don't be afraid to ask. Don't just have your network sitting there, yeah. Really use them, and, feel free to, just be prepared when you meet them, that you are prepared, for the questions that you, need to ask. Some people are busier than others. So I would just say, just don't be afraid to ask.
And that's, even with me, I'm sometimes it's, I think it's the fear of rejection is the fear that people have, and the concern that we may not have enough for someone to refer us or to help us. And the reality is, when you ask, you'd be surprised. More often than not, people will say yes. And if they can't help you the way you'd like them to, they may offer an alternative. Right. So really, really important. And having that elevator pitch, really, who am I and what do I do?
Yes.
In 20 seconds or less is very, very important.
Yes.
So now that you have all of these things in place, you have your strategy, you've conducted your assessment, you've built your resume, you're working your network. And if you've not worked your network, meaning engaging your contacts recently, this is the time to send them a note. Hey, how are you? Just checking in. I know your state is doing this or your state is doing that. Just wanted to check in and see how you're doing. The pandemic is a good opportunity to just check in with people in your network. And I've literally checked in with almost 100 people since the start of this. So when you are preparing for an opportunity for an interview, it's really important to have Wi-Fi access or reliable access. If for any reason you don't think you can hop on your laptop, assuming you have a laptop or an iPad, then you probably want to ask if the employer would be willing to do a phone interview, right? I think a lot of employers do appreciate that not everybody has a laptop. Not everybody has reliable Wi-Fi. And even if they do have a laptop or a computer, the reality is because so many people are at home, there might be so many people trying to use that one computer. So it may not be possible. And I talked about this in a webinar I did on managing the realities of telework during the pandemic. So make sure you have reliable Wi-Fi. If you don't have a laptop, use your handheld device. Almost everyone has a phone. And so ask if you can do a phone interview. So before I get to number three, there are some companies, I believe Xfinity was doing this, Spectrum, and there was a third that was offering free Wi-Fi or Wi-Fi at a reduced rate. So check with your local provider and see what they're willing to do if you have a challenge there or if you know someone who has a challenge there. But definitely do your research on the company. It's just as important that when you're building your resume, that you're tailoring your resume to the position, and to also do that in terms of your interview so that you know who you're talking to, you know what the company is about, and you're prepared to tell them why you would be a good fit for the role and talk about their culture, talk about some of their achievements, talk about some of the things that you've seen in the press about the company. That tells the employer, the interviewer, that you're interested, that this is not just something you're trying to do, that you really think that you can add value and you can help them solve some of their problems, right? So doing that research, doing your homework, knowing something about your interviewer is so, so important. And it really does impress people. Any thoughts there, Tamika?
Yeah, so I will agree with what you said. And just, you know, as you're doing your research and, you know, you're talking about the company, make sure it's something positive about the company. don't say, oh, yeah, I saw you guys were sued last year, or, you know, I saw that you had this, you had to lay off people last year. You know, concentrate on the positive of the company. Don't bring that up during the interview. And also, just when you are, you know, doing your interview, I know that we're on interview prep, I'm sorry, I guess I fast forward a little bit. Just make sure you're not talking bad about, if you're trying to leave a company, if you're with a company and you're interviewing at another company, just make sure you're not talking bad about your present company, you know, or about your supervisor or, you know, whoever has made you upset in the company. Just always keep it positive on, you know, why you are trying to move on to your next position.
Yeah, that's important. I can't tell you how many people I've interviewed for various positions, entry-level positions to C-suite level positions, who would disparage their former employee or former colleague or share someone's name. And it's like, okay.
Yeah.
Or they would share too much information.
Yeah.
I think when it comes to interviews, just being more balanced. You want to be personable, but you don't want to overshare, because confidentiality, having a level of discretion, they have to be able to trust you. And if you're oversharing, or if you're disparaging, like Tamika shared, your former employee or a former colleague, then that is not really going to make a good impression. The other thing is, you know, for me, my last two roles were in state government. I was a state official for almost 8 years, and I was recruited to fix a lot of problems, you know, big scandals, statewide issues, and there was nothing but bad news. So, you know, so for me, I wasn't sharing that, okay, I know this is happening. It was how I was going to solve it, right? People hire you to be a solution to a problem. So if it's just bad news, take that opportunity to share how you've solved similar problems in the past. And I think that's definitely going to boost your opportunity to get the role or to get an offer. The other thing is appropriate setting. You know, making sure there's not unnecessary distractions and a lot of noise in the background, and that you're set up in a place where, again, it's there's no disruptions or limited disruptions, and there's no distractions. So just doing this session and other webinars, I'm choosing a place that, okay, you can see some of these nice little aesthetics, but you're not distracted by anything else. And the same for Tamika. Any thoughts on having an appropriate setting for an interview?
Yeah, so I think this could get tricky, especially for our, you know, even though we're in the pandemic, but, you know, some of us have children that are home. And so I would say, you know, even if you have to go hide in the closet, but just make sure, you know, you bring a light, you know, you're up against a wall and they can see your face. So yeah, appropriate setting is key. And you know, you just got to find that time where maybe the child is napping, and you might even have to go outside and find a quiet place outside, you know, have yourself set up so that no one is bothering you. So just keep that in mind.
Yeah. And even if it is a closet, that's fine. Just have a, you know, if you're using a phone, you can't do this, but maybe a lamp, turn on the lights, lighting, so they can actually see your face, so you're visible. And if there's some additional stuff in your closet that you might want to get rid of or move away so that people are not seeing all your clothes and shoes and stuff like that. And so because a lot of companies are still hiring, and they have the capability to process candidate information or paperwork remotely, you want to make sure that you have, you can take a picture of your, whether it's your social security card or your passport or your driver's license. And when they require this type of information, they normally have a secure way for you to send it. But make sure you have that ready and available, and that that the means by which you're sending that information is secure. And if you're not comfortable sharing or passing on that information through an email or whatever, you can ask them for a secure alternative, or maybe based on some of the relaxed laws around around identification and employment, that they can maybe find another solution for you. But most employers, if not all, frankly, will ask for identification. And if they're doing it remotely, they'll offer a way for you to share that information in a secure fashion. But if you have to take a picture, if you have to send that information, if it's on your phone, delete it, because you definitely don't want someone to have access to your phone and see your personal identifiable information. So just be mindful of that. Again, if you're not comfortable, ask for an alternative. Every employer has to know whether or not you're eligible to work in the United States. And those companies that have the capability to receive that information remotely, just make sure that it's a secure means by which you can send that. And if you're uncomfortable, ask for an alternative. Okay. And then dress for success. Super important. Tamika, you want to take this?
Sure. Yeah, no, it's important that, you know, I know a lot of times, you know, we're on a laptop right now, or depending on how you are recording with that employer as they're interviewing for you. There was a story this week. All of us know Superman as Christopher Reeve. Well, his son is also a correspondent on Good Morning America. So this week on ABC, he had his suit and tie on and he had his laptop. But the way he had the camera positioned, guess what? He was in his underwear. He says that those were shorts, but those were underwear of which he had on. So you can go Google the clip. So he's doing the interview, you know, on live television because it's live. And people are like, what's going on? Why is he in his underwear? So it's just important that as you are doing interviews, you know, through technology, you know, you're dressed up. So, you know, putting on that suit is still, you know, required, and making sure that if you're going to, you know, not do the bottom part, that it is, you have the camera adjusted the right way, and that you still look presentable as you're going for your interview. You know, there are companies out there that are doing the type of interview where they'll ask you a pre-recorded question. And you have, you know, 4 or 5 times to answer the question. And so you could be moving the camera all around, but they still expect you to be on that recorded question interview, still expect you to be dressed up, because that's how you're going to have to show up to work for their company. So I would just make sure that you still are in that suit. You know, if you're, you know, a male with your tie, and if you're a lady, that you are, you know, still look presentable in your suit as well. And if you know you want to wear some makeup, or you know, but just make sure that you are dressed for success if you are showing up one-on-one in person, because you know, you all know the first impression is usually what, you know, how you show up is how people think of you, or leave, you know, when they leave talking about you, they're gonna say, oh wow, I saw, did you see that underwear they had on? You know, so just keep that in mind.
That is absolutely funny, and I feel bad for him. I think a lot
he made light of the situation. He did make light of the situation after. He's like, oh, I finally became a star, you know, but you don't want to be caught in that type, especially in this, you know, job market. Where...
yeah. Yeah. Nobody wants to get fame that way.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, again, this is really just to help a lot of folks who are unemployed, and this is recorded, so we will share this on our respective social media pages and websites. But it's just been great, not just connecting with you, Tamika, but also sharing these tips and recommendations for job seekers during this time, and not just during the pandemic. A lot of these are best practices for anyone who is looking or might be looking or wants to make a change in their career. So if you'd like, please take the opportunity to go to Amazon and buy Dr. Tamika Jacques' book, A Brown Girl's Guide to Employment and Networking. It was number one for new releases on Amazon under the vocational education category. I've had a chance to know her as well, and she is really an expert, not just in employment and networking, but in workforce development. And for me, if you'd like more information about my company, you could go to saintcyrconsulting.com. If you'd like me to present this topic or other leadership topics and provide training for your company, You can go to saintcyrconsulting.com or email info@saintcyrconsulting.com for more information and a consultation. But any questions from those who are joining? And Tamika, if you want to add anything else, feel free to do so.
And, yeah, so, yep, go ahead.
You can type a question, or I'm going to unmute everyone. So if you want to ask a question, you can do that as well. So feel free to type or speak, and unmute yourself if you want to speak to something that we talked about.
While any questions are being typed or asked, I just want to thank you very much, Jessie. I'm joining as your guest. So this was, you know, your mind putting this all together. So thank you so much for inviting me. You know, the feelings are mutual. You are a smart woman, and I'm so proud of, you know, your company and all the accomplishments that you have had. So just thank you so much, you know, for joining us. And I also am on YouTube. My company is Fruitful Vision Enterprises. Also, you can find my company on Facebook, Fruitful Vision Enterprises. We host girl chats every few weeks. Our next girl chat is next Wednesday at 7 p.m. And we will be hosting State Auditor Suzanne Bump from Massachusetts. So if you would love to join, we are going to have a one-on-one girl chat, and we will take questions. So thank you so much.
I've met her and met a lot of folks from her office when I was a deputy treasurer for the Commonwealth. So that's going to be a great conversation, I'm sure. And for those who are joining or who may see this recording, there is a Managing the Realities of Telework, where we talked about how to support your employees during this time, how to think about transition and where you want to be in the long term. We also talked about some best practices on self-care and how to communicate effectively, and also how to continue to performance manage and keep employees accountable, but doing that with care, consideration, and effective communication. So that's on the website, Saintcyr Consulting. And on May 14, we're going to be doing another session, a webinar, with a clinical coach and expert on mental health and how this pandemic has really impacted so many people and what leaders need to think about as they transition back to a new normal or to a new normal, and also how they can take care of themselves while they're taking care of everyone else. So look out for that information, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. Have a great night. Bye-bye.
Okay.